My name is Agri Lihanda. I was born 57 years ago in the former Kakamega district. Currently, I teach at Kabarak University. I'm a lecturer in economics in the School of Business and Economics. I've been in Kabarak for the last 10 years, but prior to that, I was in Maseno University for 11 years, from 1990 to 2001. I was raised up in a Christian family. My grandfather was a regional superintendent. Paternal grandfather was a regional superintendent in Friends Church, the late Zedekia Chayuga Aluiga. And my parents were also Christians, and they were both late parents were teachers. And they inculcated in us the value of knowing God and the academics. I schooled at Losengeli Primary School, and then passed well and proceeded to Chavakali High School in 1973 as a joint form one. Yes, but in between for my fourth form in 1976 and 1979, when I joined the university, I was a vocational student. So I graduated in 1983, and I was lucky because I passed well, and I was lucky to get a scholarship. I was sponsored by Dad. Dad is the equivalent of what is called German Academic Exchange Program. Dad is DAAD. So I was sponsored by the German under the Dad scholarship. I received the Dad scholarship to pursue master's degree in economics, which I successfully completed and graduated in 1985. I introduced myself not just as a lecturer in economics, but I introduced myself as a recovering alcoholic. And there is a deliberate reason why I do that, because the point is that addiction doesn't care about your background. It doesn't care whether you are learned or not learned. It doesn't care about your ethnic background. It doesn't care about your social status. So the purpose of saying this is that addiction, or by the time you become an addict, it is not an event like switching on the light and switching off the light. It is a process. Let it be known that addiction, whatever you're addicted to, starts as experimental and it becomes instrumental. So it's a process. My first time of testing alcohol was in 1976. Exactly 40 years ago, when I was working in Mumias as a vocational student. The Mumias Sugar Company came to Chavakali High School and did some aptitude tests for those who are completing Form 4 and those who are completing Form 6. And I emerged tops, and I was taken by Mumias Sugar Company as a vocational student. At that time, remember, in 1976, I was 17 years old, an adolescent who is experimenting with life. And you know, an adolescent would try a few things here and there. So that is the first time I tested alcohol. I can't really tell you how it was, but is that feeling, you feel bad nicely, or you feel nice badly. It's difficult to understand that. Can you picture a situation where you have a flea in your toe, a flea that becomes a jigger, and when you are scratching there, that kind of feeling, the sensation, you feel nice badly, or you feel bad nicely. So alcohol, I experimented. And let us remember also, and I want to say this to come out very clear from the very beginning, that all of us are addicts. All of us are addicted to one thing or the other. So that when you point a finger at somebody like this, like if you tell somebody you are stupid, there are three fingers here, kind of saying that you are three times as stupid as that person you are calling stupid. And this is like God is the witness. So there are various types of addiction. Some people are addicted to food. Some people are addicted to lies. Some people are addicted to Facebook. Some people are addicted to sleeping. Some people are addicted to WhatsApp. Some people are addicted to work. They are called workaholics. And whatever you are addicted to, it will have negative consequences. So that if you are addicted to work, for example, that may interfere with your relationship, your marriage, and so on. So that that work becomes, that laptop becomes a threat to your wife, for example. So to become an addict, it is a process. Some people are addicted to bang, some people are addicted to tobacco, but I'm talking about my addiction to alcohol. So I'm a recovering alcoholic. When somebody steals honey from a jar in the house, you start with the forefinger. And then after some time, you tell yourself, let me just go for the last time. You dip with two fingers. Then you go with three fingers. Then you go with four fingers. Then all the five fingers will be in the jar. And then at that point, you're saying what? You start rationalizing. This honey was bought by mom and a mom's son. So I must be having a relationship with this honey. You start rationalizing. So for me, it's a process. And being a process means that you are now drinking more, your resistance is going higher, your absorptive capacity is even increasing. If you start with half a bottle of Tusk and which you vomit, the next day you'll attempt to take three quarters. Then the other day you'll take one bottle. You thump your chest that you are a tough guy. Then you move on. I remember there was a time I would take about 16 Tuskers comfortably. But then you become monotonous. So you move to a higher level. You remember, like, for example, if you have a Peugeot 104, you'd want a 204, 304, 404, 504, 604. Once you exhaust the Peugeot series, you move to BMW. Then you move to Prado. Then you move to Hummer. No, even drinking is equally like that. You want to move to higher levels, the more potent types of alcohol. So you'd be moving from the beers to the whiskies. So that you don't want to take a whole day drinking froth things that make you go to the washroom every other time. You want something that is more lethal, something that has an immediate impact on you. So you are graduating now, not only in terms of resistance, but you are now moving to higher levels of potent drinking. Yeah. So for me, remember, I'm now completed A levels, and I'm moving to the university, moving from the rural areas to urban. So that transition from rural to urban opens other avenues. This curiosity, I remember, curiosity is a very interesting thing. The more you realize or you are told that there is a problem, the more you are warned against something, the more you want to experiment. And that is the nature of human beings. That you are told, do not step on this grass. What do you do? What are you like to do? You are like to step on it. You are told this wet. This wall is wet, and there's a warning that the wall is wet. But you'd want to experiment how wet is this wall? Sometimes you may be told usikojoe hapa. You understand it, but what are you like to do? You'll start kojoaring or peeing or urinating on that sign, and that is so there's a mixture of many things. One, there's more freedom. Two. There is, in fact, one, there is more money, because as a student at the university, you have the boom. You are getting more money with more freedom. And of course, you are not in class throughout. Like, remember, you are transiting from high school, where you would be virtually in class from 8 to 5. And then you are here, you look at the lecture timetable, and it's not mandatory that you attend classes. So you have more freedom. In an urban setting, you have transited from rural to urban, and you're a young man. Now, that time, I think I was 19 years or so. So I had more money, I had more friends, and I had to visit several spots in Nairobi. Yeah. So I drank more. But that was not having an effect on a very serious impact on my studies by then, because we had discussion groups and I was performing quite well. I completed my master's degree in 1985 and worked in the civil service. I remember I was at Kencom House as a planning officer. I was seconded by the Minister of Planning and National Development. By that time, they were seconding economists to head development planning divisions in various ministries. So I was seconded to Ministry of Cooperative Development and at Kencom House. And after about a month, I was transferred to Nyanza province as a provincial cooperative planning officer. So here is a young man who is in charge of a whole province. By then there were about, not about, there were four districts. There was Kisumu, there was Siaya, there was Kisii and South Nyanza. Provincial head, a driver, and of course a lot of money. And a lot of, you know, when you're traveling to these various districts, the district head would now be the one to host the provincial boss. And of course, I was in the ministry for some time, about 3 years, Minister of Cooperative Development, and I resigned and joined Kenya Industrial Research and Development Institute as a research officer economist. And of course, there's more money there. There was more money. In fact, I remember at Kirdi, there was even a bar in the institute, within the premise. So there was drinking at lunchtime, or maybe drinking in the evening after duty. And then after Kirdi, I worked there for about 3 years. In 1990, I joined Maseno University College. By then, it was a constituent college of Moi University. And you are moving from, say, 50 hours per week, working 50 hours per week at the institute, to 3 hours per week. So you have more money with less time in class. So if you imagine, if you are working 60 hours per week and you're moving to 3 hours per week, you have 57 hours within the weekdays, plus now the hours for the weekend. So you have more money with more freedom, more free time. Remember, an idle mind would be called what? The devil's workshop. So my drinking increased and became a very serious issue while I was a lecturer at Maseno University. And then maybe that is when you can say that is when it became a serious problem. In terms of the following one, it interfered with my performance. There are times I would be late to go to class. There are times I would forget that I'm supposed to be in class. There are times I would not be able to mark continuous assessment tests in time. There are times when I would not be able to submit marked end of semester exams in time. And of course, that the HOD and administration realized there's a problem here. So I would receive warning letters. Show course why disciplinary action should not be taken against you. There was one time I was interdicted. Apart from interfering with my performance of duty, it also had a very serious impact on my marriage. It interfered with my marriage because there were times I would neglect my responsibilities as the head of the family. In terms of, for example, not buying food, in terms of not catering for the child's needs and so on. Apart from attending church, there's also the issue of denial. And remember, you may not know this, that denial is a very, very serious, problem or challenge. And denial is not just on the part of the alcoholic. Denial is also on the part of the spouse. Often you'd hear a lady say what, that my husband is a good guy unless until he moves to so-and-so. So it's so-and-so is spoiling my husband. And that guy's wife is also pointing a finger across the face that my husband is nice except Leander. So Leander is spoiling my husband. And on the part of even parents are saying what, that my kid is so good. He's also very good in the praise and worship team. He is being spoiled by somebody else. So somebody else is always spoiling somebody. And when you meet, you converge all these people somewhere, so who would be accusing whom? Denial is a very serious point. Even the alcoholic is in denial. He'll be saying, if he's driving, he says, what, that my car knows home. I just need to ignite. Once I have the ignition on, the car arrives home, I don't even know how I got home. You have some wounds that you can't account for. You have a swollen hand, but still you'd want to go to a bar or to a Changa place to show people that you have a wound. That wound may elicit sympathy. Sympathy. So somebody say, please, have something on me. And I remember when I went so much down up to Changa drinking, I was still in denial. I didn't live in my own volition. I was sacked in the year 2001. And of course, before I was sacked, let me explain something here. My wife walked out on me in 1999. And I was alone. And that gave me both freedom and bitterness. Because I got information that she was staying with somebody, and that made me very bitter. And of course, I went deeper into drinking. It's like, you see, if you remove a speed governor, then the drive is likely to accelerate. If you are doing 80, you are likely to do 81 and move to 90 and so on. So my drinking increased, and of course, that affected my performance, and I was eventually sacked. I was sacked in 2001. After working for 11 years in Maseno University, I was sacked as a lecturer. Initially, when I was sacked, I was very bitter. I was bitter because I was without a wife and I was without a job. And of course, the terminal benefits I was given at Maseno gave me more mileage in drinking. And it had a very devastating impact on me because for 5 years, I was jobless. Imagine you have a master's degree from the University of Nairobi. By then, there were only two universities in Kenya, Kenyatta University and the University of Nairobi. So I was jobless for 5 years. And in the village is like you're moving from grass to grass. In the village, you know, you have some little money from the university, terminal dues. You can't carry every villager to the bar. So what is likely to happen? The village will carry you from up there to where they are. So I switched now, my drinking was now away from formal bars to unregulated spots like Changa places.